The best choice here is a disk herniation. So a couple features that's important for this case. Notice that there's a mass lesion, and on the axial view, you can see the mass lesion is within the left subpedicular zone. It is epidural in location. There's epidural fat, expansion of the epidural space, and also causing effacement of the left lateral recess. On the right-hand side, you can see the traversing nerve root that is widely open in the lateral recess. On the left side, the nerve root has been compressed. Also, there's degenerative disc on the one level above at L3-4. The disc is dehydrated or desiccated disc. And the most important feature is the way the lesion enhances. The enhancement pattern is peripheral rim enhancement on the sagittal view and also on the post-contrast axial view. Notice that there's a very little central enhancement that distinguishes it from others such as meningioma or schwannoma. So for disc herniation, you want to categorize them into disc protrusion versus extrusion versus sequestration. It's a good idea to try to keep the language consistent. This is a review article that with nomenclature that we are using. So it's a good idea to look into this article or other type of review article. You can find that in Radiopedia or other sites such as radiologyassistant.nl. The distinction between disc herniation and disc bulge is actually quite simple on paper. Basically, you take a cross-sectional image on the axial view. You divide the disc into four quadrants, so 25% or 90 degree. If the disc material extending beyond the confine of the vertebral body, more than 25%, that's disc bulge. In this case, all four quadrants involved, so you have a symmetric expansion or symmetric disc bulge or diffuse disc bulge or circumferential disc bulge. Sometimes you have the disc bulge that's asymmetric distribution. In this case, involving only three quadrants, this is the asymmetric disc bulge. If the disc material extending beyond the confine of the vertebral body for less than 25% or less than 90 degree, that's classified as disc herniation. For disc herniation, you can further classify them into disc protrusion versus disc extrusion versus sequestration. For extrusion, if the herniated head is smaller than the neck, either on the sagittal view or on the axial view, that's protrusion. On the other hand, if the herniated part is greater than the neck, either on the sagittal view or on the axial view, that's extrusion. If the extruded material break off from the parent disc, that's sequestration. In this case, we have either a sequestration or a inferiorly migrated disc extrusion from L3-4. Let's look at the other answers that do not work as well. For choice B and C, meningioma versus schwannoma or peripheral nerve sheath tumor. First of all, the location is off. For both lesions, they are the top two differential diagnoses for intradural extramedullary location. This is an epidural disease. Also, the way it enhances is also wrong. For meningioma or for schwannoma, they should enhance quite avidly and centrally. Whereas for disc fragment, disc, because you do not have a central blood supply, centrally, the disc should not enhance. You can have peripheral enhancement like this, especially after surgery. So both location and the enhancement pattern is wrong for choice B and C. These are the example for both meningioma on the top. You can see a dural tail right here. Intradural extramedullary lesion causes core compression. There's a schwannoma, also an intradural extramedullary lesion. Notice that both lesions enhance relatively homogeneously and centrally, not peripheral enhancement like a disc. Choice D, synovial cyst. This is an example of a biopsy-proven synovial cyst. You can see at first glance on the sagittal view, it could look very much like a disc herniation or disc extrusion. But remember, synovial cyst is a cyst, so centrally it should be bright on T2, whereas disc tend not to be bright. However, you can have a synovial cyst that's heavily calcified, so they could be dark on T2 sometimes. The enhancement pattern probably doesn't help you because synovial cysts, like a cyst, tend to enhance just peripherally, should not enhance centrally unless it's infected. But the key thing here is that notice its relationship between the adjacent severely degenerated facet joint, facet effusion, and that's continuous with a synovial cyst. And this, of course, can cause mass effect and compression nerve root, and the surgeon has to take it out, just like in this case, and then send it to pathology, a proven synovial cyst. What about Cho's E post-surgical scar tissue? The distinction between scar tissue versus recurrent disc is quite important after surgery. This patient did have a surgery. It's very difficult sometimes to tell them apart, especially if the scar tissue is formed in the shape of a disc. And the key thing is that the way it enhances. For a enhancing granulation tissue or for scar tissue, because it does have a blood supply, it tend to enhance quite ably and homogeneously. Whereas for the disc, it does not have central blood supply. The enhancement will come from a very, very slow enhancement by diffusion. So in a normal post-contrast sequences, you should not see central enhancement for the disc, whereas scar tissue tends to enhance quite homogeneously. Notice that it's quite difficult to differentiate between a disc and a scar tissue until you give contrast. So that's one reason we do elect to give contrast on a post-surgical patient, even if the clinician is not worried about infection. So for this case, the best choice here is disc herniation, sequestration, or inferiorly migrated disc extrusion. That's all for this spine case number 9. Thank you for your attention. Good luck on your board exam.